Welcome back to Wombology Championship Sunday, Day 2. It's our final quarterfinal here with Samuel Tarly and Sottle here on Twitch. Braun Strowman, whichever you want to go for. He's got a ponytail. Make fun of him.
So, apparently, the Samuel Tarly thing is something that Callum has experienced before, but I just saw it on Twitter for the first time, and it's absolutely killed me.
Who tweeted this? I thought this was Twitch chat.
It was a tweet. It was Nymeria. I've just had a cannot unsee moment, so thanks Nymeria for ruining Callum for me forever. You are now officially Samuel Tarly to me.
I gotta abuse this person.
Callum.
I gotta abuse
Callum, there are hosting duties to take care of right now.
No, I gotta abuse someone on Twitter.
Alright, cool, that's fine. I'll take care of it.
So. No, it's okay. I'm here. I got it. We're here for our final quarterfinal. Zelay versus Hoy. The winner will go on to face Life Coach in the semi-finals. No former Archon showdown between Zelay and Fireball. That's not an option anymore. Zelay, of course, carrying the final hope of Archon after Orange lost earlier on to Ryzen. And we're set for a pretty stacked semi-final lineup here, and the winner of this is going to join and not diminish that in any way, in fact enhance the lineup of our semi-finals. Very excited to see Zelay versus Hoy. Talked about this yesterday, these EU versus NA clashes.
Yes.
We have seen things like, Fireback versus Life Coach. We've seen the high-level ones like that before. But guys like Hoy, who don't necessarily come to every tournament, and Zelay as well, who aren't as ubiquitous in tournaments as guys like Life Coach and Fireback. It's a really interesting matchup for me. These are two players who have their very own, you know, personalities, their own characteristics that I really like, and really intrigued to see these two playstyles mash into each other.
Yeah, it's interesting to me on the EU versus NA thing, because there's, you know, it's a great fun argument that everyone in esports loves to have, but there's a bunch of different levels you can take it on in Hearthstone. Like, when we say, you know, who's better, EU or NA, are we talking about like a 5v5 where we each region picks their best five players, the very top five, or do we want to see how deep the talent pool goes? And when you talk about how deep the talent pool goes, once you start getting down to top 10, top 20 in the region, that's when these names like Hoy and Zelay start to come into it based on what we've seen from people. So it's an interesting point to match up these two guys. Personally, I would consider Hoy a little bit further ahead than Zelay. I think Hoy is really up there with the very best. He's just waiting to really find his big breakout to get his name out there. But I think just objectively analyzing his play, he's an absolute monster. And someone who I'm personally a huge fan of, who I love seeing to play in tournaments.
Yeah, for me, you know, the whole EU-NA thing, that, you know, there is a thing and you can get into the different levels of it. For me, just on a very basic level, it's interesting because you see matchups you don't necessarily see all the time. So there's a lot of tournaments where you, particularly in Europe, there's a lot of tournaments in Europe where mostly European players will take part. So if you want to see a matchup you've never seen before, it's more than likely an NA versus EU matchup.
Right. Yeah, that's very good.
Yeah, I don't know if this match between Zelay and Hoy, for example, Rado from Gosu Gamers can correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah.
I'm not sure this matchup has ever taken place before.
It's possible, yeah. I mean, there's a lot of tournaments that go on, especially now as Hearthstone keeps growing. You know, there's a ton of tournaments going on right now. There's going to be
There's three at one time.
Yeah, exactly. There'll be a ton going on again next week. Like, there is just always a tournament to play in these days. Even, you know, the behind-the-scenes open tournaments for HCT points, for example. Who knows if these guys have been counted each other in there. It seems unlikely because of the different region thing again. But, you know, there's always these things going on, so everyone around the scene has potentially run into each other at some point, but in terms of visibility, again, it's very exciting to see these players from different regions get matched up against each other.
All right, these guys are ready to go, but let's run through the lineups before we get them started. Zelay has his Warrior, Warlock, and Druid, and the Mage has been banned, which we know was a Freeze Mage from yesterday. And the Druid, Hunter, and Warlock for Hoy, one of only two Hunters, and there's Pidgey there to help him out. His Warrior has been banned.
Yeah, so what are we down to?
That's the second time today we've seen a Freeze Mage player try and ban out the Warrior and then have their Mage banned.
Mage banned in response, right. Hoy is still left with the Druid, which would have been a good answer to the Mage anyway, but I guess the Warrior just being banned out is generally pretty solid against Zelay's list. Obviously the Freeze Mage and the Druid, Hoy was definitely playing Patron, right? We've messed this up once already, but I'm pretty sure Hoy was playing Patron.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
So we are going to see a Druid mirror match in game one.
Oh, goody!
I do love a good Druid mirror. We had a good Druid
mirror. We had a really good one, actually. Yeah.
Like, but as Druid mirrors go,
yeah,
pretty good.
We did have a really good one because the combo cards were forced to be used for board control during the mid-game turns. I think like two Force of Natures and one Savage Roar were used between the two players to fight the board early, which meant that the game was a lot more honest later on. There was this really like compelling fight for board control late on, as opposed to just one player comboing and winning the game. So it can happen. Druid mirrors do have the potential to be interesting, but overall, it's kind of a matchup that we've all seen a million times right now, and we kind of know the path that it takes. So, you know, we'll see how it goes.
Well, it looks like we missed the mulligans there, but it's an innervated shade for Zalay on turn one. So he's giving up a little bit of card advantage in the early game to develop this early shade. We talked about this in the Druid Mirror we had, I think it was yesterday, that the turn one shade, the innervated out shade, even without a turn two follow-up play, can be really big in the Druid Mirror.
Yeah, we talked about the merits of it before. We were talking about a particular life coach turn where innervate shade didn't fit his curve. Skip turn innervate shredder into shade would actually have fit his curve a lot better, but he respected the value of getting that shade down early because it just becomes such a dominant minion after it's grown for two or three turns. Druid has no way to interact with it while it's in stealth, just no possible way in the deck once it's grown up beyond the 2/2 that spell power swipe can kill. So yeah, there's a lot of value to early shade, and if you don't get the big ramp turns with the wild growths, the two early shades that Zalay has is one of the dream draws that you can have in the Druid.
Oh, Pidgey really wants to see what's going on here. That bird just pops up all the time.
You have no interest in Hearthstone anymore, do you, Callum? You're just bird watching right now.
When there are pets involved, yeah. I'm all about it. All
right, cool. But yeah, back to Hoy here. He has he has two innervates in hand right now. The second one, probably a little bit overkill at this point since he can't go all the way through to Dr. Boom this turn, but looks like getting out the Emperor here to speed up the rest of his turn is going to make a lot of sense. It is immediately contested by that 5/5 shade that's about to grow if Zalay feels the need to make the trade, which I'm sure he will, but still, the discount on cards for the follow-up turns is pretty strong, but Zalay is able to deal with this nice and easily because of, like I said, that shade growing to a pretty dominant size early on. He can just curve out nicely with the Shredder if he wants to go down that line.
Is there a consideration here of using the Savage Roar, do you think? Because then you can use the smaller shade to trade, and then hit face for 7 and get some damage in early.
Normally, using Savage Roar as a removal, you want it to create a really big advantage, or you're using it as kind of an emergency thing when you don't have a better option.
Sure.
So in this situation, I wouldn't really favor it. I think I'd just take the honest trade and develop the Shredder, but the Savage Roar is a possibility, but you would, of course, be revealing the second shade as well, most likely, because you wouldn't want to give up on that 7 damage to face. So it does open you up a little bit to counterplay with the discounted cards and removal options.
Yeah. A better option would maybe, yeah, it looks like he's going to use the Keeper of the
Brilliant Grove and trade the 3/3.
Yes. Yeah. I like any way you're able to use the 3/3 rather than the 5/5 shade, I think.
Sure. I like getting the Shredder down this time. I mean, it's... You have two extra power with the shade that sure continues to grow over time, but if you just sacrifice the 5/5 and kept the 3/3, that 3/3 still continues to grow, and you actually develop a minion with two extra power on the board anyway. So the amount of total power in play is similar, and I'd rather have a Keeper of the Grove in my hand as a utility card than the Shredder in my hand, because the Keeper is a faster card to be able to play on a following turn.
All right, well, Zalay disagreed. He did go for the Keeper of the Grove there, and he has, if Hoy goes into the Shredder here, Zalay has the Wrath and then the Keeper of the Grove to deal with it a little bit cleaner, so might work in his favor in that respect. But there's also the Azure Drake option and the Lotheb for Hoy, so lots of 4-drops here, more 4-drops than you'd expect.
Yeah, I'd expect to see the Lotheb come down this turn. Next turn, he has the option of Drake innervate swipe if the board is presented to be strong for that. So I like the Lotheb here. He's again asking for a trade from the opponent from this shade, which I don't think Zalay will make here. Leaving that shade on the board at 1 health probably isn't too appealing to him. But this time he has the Shredder to play out, but.
No, I mean, that just plays far too much into swipe.
Right, exactly, yeah. It would be a brutal swipe if he made that trade. So the Lotheb here just is much stickier, and again, it's the same thing before. He developed a slower card in Lotheb, which also has the potential to be stickier because of the locking out of the spells, and he has the faster card in the Azure Drake left over in his hand.
All right, well, Zalay, he has two options this turn, really, in terms of what to play. He can play the Shredder, or he can just Hero Power Pass. And obviously he does have to consider that trade as well.
Yeah.
Is there any consideration of if you play the Shredder, trading the Keeper of the Grove in so that the Lotheb can't survive trading with the Shredder?
I don't think so. You have the Lotheb would survive at one health, and you have that Wrath or the Hero Power next turn to be able to tidy that up. So I think going face, being aggressive while you have this Stealth Shade in play and the Savage Roar in hand, you really need to start making an impact on your opponent's life total. So face is the place there, I believe.
Face is indeed the place. So lots of removal options, as we talked about, for Holly here, the Swipe and the Wrath, as well as Azure Drake. So which order do you think he wants to play them in here?
It's a little bit awkward. The numbers don't really line up very nicely. There's no target for a 5-power Swipe, and the 2 residual damage across the board doesn't really do anything. Same thing, the spell power on the Wrath doesn't really get anything done. So we might just end up seeing a Wrath and Shredder and keep the Drake for later on, just Wrathing down the piloted Shredder, trading into the 2-4 with the Lotheb and developing a Shredder of his own.
If a 1-health minion comes off the Shredder, do you think you go for Swipe then?
Quite possibly. It's a consideration for sure.
Especially if it's a Patient Assassin or something. Yeah, Puddle Stomper, not really that great for him to line up to, and actually pretty bad to line up the Shredder into.
Yeah, he might be forced to now trade into the 3-2. No, he's going to go face. He's trying to establish himself as the dominant player in this matchup. But I think that's a little bit ambitious in the situation that he's in. I think the trade into the 3-2 was probably marginally better value to try and protect the Shredder. You need to kind of present a situation on the board where your opponent is forced to reveal that Shade to make a good trade. Then you can try and deal with it. If you keep going face and letting the opponent trade on their turns, it becomes less and less likely overall that the Shade is forced to be revealed. And I think if that Shade is never revealed this game until lethal, then that's a game that Hoi quite often loses.
21 damage potential with the Savage Roar and the Hero Power. So, not too far away.
It's not. It's definitely getting there. So yeah, Wrath comes down here on the Shredder. He has plenty of options with the 3-power minion, the 2-power minion, or to trade into this, and the Aspirant comes out.
Oh dear.
That is pretty hideous.
This is the first Aspirant we've seen from either of these players. It doesn't look like either of them are playing it in their list from what we can see.
Yep.
Well, they've just not drawn it. But the Aspirant hasn't been a factor, and yeah, that's pretty brutal.
It is. And he is going to trade the Shade here. Wow, okay.
Oh, dear.
So Hoi's attack... This is exactly the kind of thing I'm talking about with Hoi. I think that play he made by going phase was wrong. Just in terms of optimal Hearthstone, your standard by-the-book Hearthstone, if you like, I think it was incorrect. But the play he made caused Zalae to respect his aggression and pull that Shade out of stealth, which now puts him in the position where he has the board clear with the Azure Drake. Sure, Zalae now has the Dr. Boom follow-up, but he's in a much nicer position now than he would have been
with
that
7-7 shade. That's the game.
Still. What?
With the combo, if he wants to use it when he gets there. Just happens to draw, you know, 2 innervates. Say, it's got a combo, it's over.
Okay, I mean, I've seen people miscount mana by maybe 1, maybe 2 at a push. Three, Callum, is a bit much.
I wasn't miscounting the mana. I was
you said the game was over.
I was joking.
Okay. All right. Fine.
I'm not that dumb. Okay. I do know that 6 is not the same as 9.
Okay.
I'll
take your word for it.
I'll take my word for it. Great. Yeah. So what can he do here? He can go with the Sludge Belcher to stall, which feels pretty good, unless you end up with some Boombot shenanigans.
Yeah, I think it's the only real option here. The Force of Nature is completely miserable. You'd have to full trade Force of Nature and the Drake just into the 7-7. Getting the Sludge Belcher in play to potentially soften up the Dr. Boom gives you more reach for a potential clear with the Force of Nature. But let's work this one out now.
Let's do some maths here.
So 3 from a Boombot goes into the Sludge Belcher. Let's pretend that the Boombots always hit the Drake and don't do anything relevant. 3
face.
Goes in, 2 goes in, the other Boombot goes in, and then you then have 21 to go face.
12 plus 9, yeah, 21.
Yeah, so he needs some help from the Boombots here. Didn't really get it. 1 to face and a hit on the Azure Drake, so No lethal here, but I think I like the combo here anyway, just because it did present so much additional value with those boom bots.
Yeah, I mean, and Holly did have to be aware that his opponent has ramped so much more mana than him and was heading towards that, and actually puts himself at 14 health here, so if an innervate comes off the top, he'll die on the backswing. Have we seen two innervates from Holly? I think we might have seen both.
We've seen both, yeah. He had both in his hand early. Used one to get the Emperor out early, and then used one for the Azir Drake swipe.
Sure. Yeah, so Zalay feels comfortable in doing that and putting himself to 14. Otherwise, that would have been, you know, a potential concern.
Mm-hmm. And that Aspirant that came off the Shredder might be relevant here, because Hoi's now an extra turn away from being able to steal the game with that combo. It looks like the game is going to go one or two more turns. So if we get to that position, yeah, he would have had 9 mana next turn,
right?
Potentially. So, you know, that Aspirant drop could be relevant.
I said earlier, you know, I said a couple of minutes ago that Zalay had ramped so much more than his one, but it was one wild growth. Yeah. It was one wild growth plus the D ramp for Hoi from the Aspirant.
That'll do.
That's it. The game is now over.
Yeah. Zalay raises his eyebrows and thinks, a charging 4-4 is pretty solid here. I think I'll win the game.
Exactly for Zalay. So I did once completely miscall the result of a series, thinking that the person that was 2 games up had won and won the series and went into a big has won the match spiel.
I did that on the Blizzard casting desk the other week at EU Previews.
Wow.
Yeah, the game ended and I like spoke for 30 seconds about the wrong person winning the game. No one told me. Production didn't tell me in my ears. My co-casters didn't tell me. They just let me keep going. It was fine.
Yeah, don't you hate it when people are assholes to you and you're casting with them? So
yeah, it sucks.
It's really horrible.
But yeah, anyway, I just want to go back and talk about that moment with the Loetheb attacking face and then the respect from Zalay, mm-hmm. the trade with the 7-7. I think it was a really important turn there. It's something that I brought up a couple of times during this broadcast about Hoi, that he does like to impose the mental side of the game on his opponent. And that's all that Loetheb attack to face was. It was him trying to assert dominance, make his opponent feel a little bit timid about leaving the Loetheb up on the board again and taking more damage. It turns out that, you know, the 7-7 trade into the 5-5 is actually okay from Zalay's perspective, because even if his board did get cleared, he had the Dr. Boom follow-up anyway, so he probably felt quite secure. Even if he did lose that board, he was in a strong position. But it just goes to show what imposing yourself mentally on your opponent can make happen in these kind of situations where you're a little bit behind. Because what Hoi was saying with that attack is, I'm actually ahead here, like, I'm the one that gets to be dominant and attack face, you have to trade. And Zalay ended up actually respecting that a little bit, but it wasn't enough for Hoi to come back into the series.
Yep, so Hoi's going to go ahead and move on to his Hunter here. And he's going to go into the Druid. Now, we did see the only other player in the tournament playing Hunter lose 3-0 to Druid in our first quarterfinal. So let's hope, for Hoi's sake, that he can he'll be hoping to avoid that similar fate.
Sure. I mean, if there's a deck that's capable of doing it in the meta right now, Druid is definitely one of them. It does have those draws that just curve out and kill you. 6-0 did get 3 of them in a row, for sure. Tweeted that he felt disgusted with himself with how well he drew with Druid. And yeah, we'll see if Zalay can replicate his former teammate's success with the Druid deck here. But Hoi is going to queue up his aggressive Hunter and try and snipe out the Druid here, but Druid, in a lot of situations, does okay in this matchup, as long as the Druid player recognizes when they need to be aggressive.
So a good start drawn for Hoi here. The coin Haunted Creeper into Glaive Zooka feels pretty good.
Yeah.
There is a quick shot as well. Yeah, he's going to get rid of the Eaghorn Ball. You don't want the two weapons.
Yeah, also known as the Fireball Creeper, because you usually end up doing about 6 damage with Haunted Creeper into Glaive Zooka. That Haunted Creeper is such a pain in the ass to deal with. It normally gets to attack a couple of times, and then the residual 1-1s get to do some damage as well. So, yeah, it's usually a nightmare. And just the Haunted Creeper in its vanilla form here is a great answer to the Living Roots.
Yeah, we did see the Lepronome drawn, which might have made Hoi think twice about the coin double 2 drop, but having that 1 drop, obviously. But, yeah, he's just going to go ahead and play the Creeper because it's a good answer to the Living Roots. Hoi can clear it up to a certain extent here, though. He can leave just the 1 Spectral Spider. We'll see if that's the line he chooses to go down. Of course, the Animal Companion pick him as well for Hoi. This is a really pretty good hand. That Explosive Trap isn't great, but it's going to do His hand's going to get a lot of work done in the early game until that Keeper of the Grove comes down. I think the Gleavesook is still the play here, though.
Seems good. Yeah, gets a lot of damage in, gets the weapon developed this turn. But you saw the level of... What? What are you laughing at?
Sorry, no, I just enjoyed you completely seamlessly coming in after I had to vamp because you were dying a little bit.
Yeah, I was. I was quietly dying there, but... Yeah,
it's fine. Saul nearly choked to death live on air there. I like the pro that I am, covered it.
Yeah, he nailed it.
Seamlessly. Callum. Until I wanted to point out to show everyone.
But yeah, Glaivezooka developed there definitely seems like the play, but I just like to acknowledge the level of respect for that Haunted Creeper from Zalay. Part of it was that his turn two was hero power there anyway, so he kind of wanted a target for his hero power, so he felt like he might deal with it, but you just see the efficiency of these Death Rattle minions that started to come into the game in Naxxramas and basically supplanted all other early game drops just because of how great a platform they are. For you to have something that just sticks to the board almost always, it's just such a good platform to build on. It's going to be such a huge change for the game when they're cycled out in standard format because they have pretty much defined all early game aggressive decks since they've been released.
Absolutely. So the Animal Companion seems to be strong here for Hoi's, hoping for anything but Leok.
As is often the case. Yep, Misha will do.
I mean, Huffer would be... Okay, I actually think... Oh, Swipe changes things slightly, I guess, maybe.
Yep.
And with the Wrath as well, I think either is potentially
right,
not
but
that great.
Before the Swipe was drawn, both Huffer or Misha were going to get 4 damage in. But, you know, the Huffer would have actually been worse because of the development play of the Keeper of the Grove on curve. So Misha against Druid is quite often the best option for that reason. But the Swipe being drawn did let Zalay come out with a pretty efficient answer there. But Hoi is following up this curve pretty nicely here with the Lepinome hero power. He's still representing some threat on board, but he's now pretty much out of stuff to do. And he's not quite there yet with being able to just burn his opponent down.
What do you think of the Azure Drake right there rather than clearing the Leper Gnome?
Oh, 100%. Like I said at the start of this matchup, you need to establish the turn where you can start to make an aggressive play. You can't just sit back and clear your opponent's board every turn because they're just going to keep pressing hero power. You're going to take damage from a charge minion, you're going to clear it, you're then going to take more damage from the hero power, there'll be another minion, you clear it. Like, it's a never-ending cycle that ends up with you losing the game. Eventually, you have to just develop a stronger minion than your opponent in play and start to say to them, okay, I'm going to race. I'm going to represent the fact that I have Savage Roar in my deck and just start ignoring your stuff and activate the race.
Well, Hoi, choosing not to deal with the Azure Drake did have options with the Hunter's Mark and the Quick Shot, instead developing the Snake Trap. Mm-hmm. There's a Thorisson, which Zalay could opt to go for here. Not too sure these are a lot of cards he wants to discount, the Wild Growth and the Wraths.
I mean, they're pretty good. The Wraths are really efficient clearing options. If you get those down to one mana, they fit in really nicely.
True.
You can actually develop the board at the same time you're casting Wraths a lot better. Keeper of the Grove, same thing. Very, very efficient card to fight back against Hunters here. So it's actually a pretty nice card hand to be able to discount. It also means that anytime a Savage Roar is drawn, he can then cast the combo on turn 8. So he accelerates his clock by one turn.
And can cast the combo with hero power and turn 10 if he makes just that one damage extra reach.
Yeah, I'm not entirely sure this game is getting to turn 10 though, Callum.
That's awesome.
I'm perfectly fine with this Keeper hero power play though. There are limits to the being aggressive thing here. You do have to respect that the Hunter is a better deck than you overall at dealing damage. So the Keeper hero power getting into a dominant position here, not having to deal with that minion ever in the case of Snake Trap. I can definitely get on board with this too.
Now this is an interesting spot for Hoi, I think, because there is the option of Unleash the Hound's Kill Command here.
Yeah.
Just Kill Command face, and then you've established a beast on board, which you don't have any other minions in hand, and you have activators for Snake Trap.
Yeah, that is a possibility. The downside of that is that you miss your hero power this turn, which if you're really trying to activate the race here, you really want to get in that hero power every turn so that you're maximizing your damage over time. He might look to maybe set up some defensive play because these minions are scary here and he has that explosive trap that he can leverage against a potential combo, but he needs to find some way to lower the health of these minions on board so that they're not a problem. Hoi starts with pressing the hero power there, which kind of goes some way to talk about his mentality. He knows he wants to weave that in every turn. Tanya. He's just going to go for the burn option, play the explosive trap to just deal 2 extra damage, and hope that Unleash the Hounds and Kill Command is potential lethal on the following turns.
Yeah, Zalea has to be a little bit concerned about his life total here, but there's not really anything he can do about it.
No. Even wrathing his own stuff to try and draw, say, Ancient of Lore or draw Savage Roar so he can potentially win the game next turn, even that kind of stuff is dangerous here, because if you wrath your own stuff, you have the spell power up, and you're just going to lose it to the explosive trap, so... He's in a bit of a rough position here. Does choose to activate the explosive trap, so takes the 2 additional damage. And now, just with the state of the board now, he has 2 damage from the dogs. Kill command is 7, plus the 2 from the hero. Wow, I think this is now just lethal, right? No, he doesn't have mana to fit in the hero power, so... A little bit short, I believe. Unleash kill command will be 8, plus the 2 from the weapon, but 1 mana short of being able to press that button.
Yep. Does get the Eagle Horn Bow as well, so it can hit with the weapon and then refill with the Eagle Horn Bow. But yeah, so he has the explosive up. So the 4-2 and the 2-2 are going to die. There's 5.
No, this is Snake that's left up.
Oh, of course, yeah, because the explosive already hit. So yep. He needs to deal with this board.
Yep.
What's the way to deal with it?
We have Hunter's Mark, which helps. Mm. Not actually a common inclusion in most aggressive.
Yeah, I was going to say that when we saw it. It was, yeah, an interesting choice. I think it's interesting because the Hunter's Mark almost incentivizes killing the Thoris in here and leaving the other 2 up, potentially. Mm. Though, with the discount, of course, Savage Roar would still be lethal by a long way if he just kills the 1.
Yeah, but he is playing around just Force of Nature being lethal this way for sure, and I believe just Savage Roar as well. 6 plus 6, 12, 13, yeah. So he's reduced his opponent's outs to just having combo, which is probably the right level of safety that you want to play for here. And okay, he's going to go ahead and kill command here, so he gains the 2 extra damage from having a beast, which covers the 2 damage he would have got from pressing hero there anyway. Ancient of Lore is pretty solid, but he can't clear the board along with it, is the problem, because of the snake trap.
Right.
He can play Ancient of Lore, he can wrath 1 hound, but then he'd have to leave the other hound there, because if he trades into it, there's the potential for it to just... Well, it will just spawn 3 more, so...
Yeah, so if he leaves 1 hound and heals back up to 8,
mm-hmm.
What are Hoy's outs? I think it's just second kill command?
No, there's a lot of outs. So he'll already have 6 damage lined up. So abusive.
Right, yeah. So he only has 2.
Abusive sergeant, quick shot, argent horse rider. So many things will get the job done. Yeah. Here.
Sorry, I was miscounting. I didn't include the bow.
That was my
problem there. But that's definitely not it.
That's only 1 extra damage. He can play Glaivezuka to buff and then overwrite with the Eagle Horn Bow.
Yeah.
That is only 7. So, Hoy finds himself 1 damage short here.
Do you go for that, though?
Interestingly enough, if he'd have just pressed hero power on the previous turn instead of kill commanding, he would have lethal here because he's retained the beast. So he would have had that 2 extra damage with the previous hero power. He could have hero powered again this turn, plus the kill command, plus the Eagle Horn Bow. So his decision to invest there with the kill command early has cost him because... But, you know, I say it covers the 2 damage you get from the hero power anyway, but that's the best it gets, right? Mm-hmm. You know, if you press the hero power, you do the same amount of damage total anyway, right? Because even if you lose your beast, you kill command for 3 on the next turn, but you've already gained 2 extra damage on the previous turn by pressing the hero power. So it is a little bit of a strange choice to go ahead and kill command there, but it also has the added benefit of playing around Lothev, so you can't call it strictly wrong. But lots of interesting decisions that do go into even playing Face Hunter, Callum, believe it or not.
Well, you know, I talked about it yesterday as being like mini Freeze Mage, and is... Where do we stand now? That's 7 plus 6. That is lethal, yes. Yeah. So Zalay going to go out to a 2-0 lead here. Just the Warlock left for Hoy to come back here. Might be about to get back on schedule after our... Life coach intervention.
Yeah, quick Druid 3-0 is just what we need to get back on schedule here. But yeah, that turn, that game, although it was you know, fairly straightforward and came down to a few top decks on the end, the key thing was that turn that you questioned, where instead of just respecting the Lepinome and removed it, he chose to develop that big Azir Drake and start getting the pressure back onto his opponent the following turn. That allowed him to set up a lethal of his own. Came down to a very tense game at the end that could have gone either way based on Hoi's decision with the kill command or based on the top decks, but the important thing is that Zalay found that point in the mid game to start being aggressive.
Yeah. As you say, if he even waited, you know, another turn to do that, he might have been a turn too late and Hoi would have got the damage he needed there. All right, so Zalay 2-0 up here, and it's going to be the Warlock of Hoi. Can you remember which Warlock deck it was?
I don't off the top of my head. We saw a lot of Warlocks yesterday in my defense.
I'm trying to think of all the Warlocks we've seen back today. I don't know if we've seen any Zoo. I think we've only seen Reno Lock.
We've only seen, Control Warlocks come back today.
There's a couple of players didn't get to play theirs.
Looking at Zalay's lineup, I think the Reno Lock makes sense in his lineup. And yeah, it is a Reno Lock again from... Hoi. I was actually looking at Hoi's lineup. I just said Zalay for some reason.
Well, they are both playing Warlock, and I think...
Yeah.
I don't know. I can't remember what Zalay is playing.
The Reno Lock does make a lot of sense in Hoi's lineup, so I was expecting to see it. It is what we see here. And not the greatest of starts, for sure, but lining it up into the Druid. You can also highly expect it to be the Control Warlock, because he chose not to pick it into the Druid and chose the Hunter instead. If it was a Zoo deck, you feel like he would have slam-picked it into the Druid, so... it is the Reno Lock, not the greatest opening hand. Dark Peddler comes out this time, which is not a bad start. Didn't quite catch the rest of the Mulligan. Okay, Peddler into in-game boss. Pretty great start against the Druid overall.
Yeah, Living Roots is going to be a little bit problematic for the Peddler, though.
It is, but the Druid is not going anywhere fast based on their hand anymore.
Yeah.
So you do have time to establish that in-game boss later on if you want to. Be very surprised to see the coin used here. I think you just follow the natural curve, play the Peddler on 2, Imp-Gang Boss on 3.
Living Roots is quite interesting because a lot of people thought it would be good early on, but I think some people tested it and weren't necessarily all that enamored with it straight away, particularly as it came out at the same time as Aspirant, right? Everyone was picking the Aspirant into their early game of their Druid. Mm-hmm. But now people are cycling out those Aspirants and realizing the double Living Roots in your deck is actually a really great utility card, even just as 2/1/1s on turn one.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. The thing with Living Roots is it's so much more flexible than Aspirant. Sure, it's a great card in the early game. So is Aspirant. You know, Living Roots can shoot down a Knife Juggler. It can be 2/1/1s on turn one. It can deal with a turn one Secret Keeper from Secret Paladin. It can do all these things. The point is, if you draw it later, you can tempo it out with Azir Drake to do 3 damage. You can add it to the end of your combo on turn 10, or if you've Emperored to change your damage from 14 to 16. It does all these additional things later in the game that Aspirant just doesn't do. You just draw a Rivercroft.
We love that it's Rivercroft. Not another, it can't be another 2/3. It has to be Rivercroft.
Well, it's the closest you get, right? To a vanilla 2/3. Most other 2/3s actually have some sort of ability on it.
So the in-game boss coming out on turn 3. We see another Corruption. Not the first one we've seen this tournament so far, coming off the Peddler.
Yeah, one of those niche cards that kind of Discover is introduced into the game. You talked about Reno decks introducing more cards into the game and making it more interesting from a viewer perspective. I think Discover has very much done the same thing. It kind of brings these niche little things that aren't good enough to put in your deck, but sometimes have that situation. Things like Corruption get the opportunity to actually see play in competitive Hearthstone now and just kind of increases the variety of the viewer experience, which I think is really awesome. I think almost universally, Discover is agreed upon to be a great mechanic that Blizzard introduced.
And it brings back a lot of cards that have been kind of cycled out as they've been replaced from the basic and classic sets, like Shieldbearer in Zoo, for example. If you Peddler into Shieldbearer, it's often very useful. Museum Curator into things like Harvest Golem and Cairn Bloodhoof.
Yeah.
You never feel bad about getting Cairn Bloodhoof off a Museum Curator if you can play it on curve.
Right. The old bad boy Cairn. That thing used to be so dominant. Just used to be...
Yeah.
You know, these days, like, the recommended legendary craft list, it's like, you know, get yourself a Dr. Boom, get yourself Sylvanas, maybe pick up a Tyrion if you want to play Secret Paladin, this kind of stuff. Back in the day, like, the recommended list was like, get yourself Rag and get yourself Cairn, and then you're good to go. It's like,
yeah, Rag was like number one when it was just the classic and basic sets.
Yeah, because no one was playing Big Game Hunter for some reason. Like, it's so bizarre when you look at the game now, but yeah, that's the state where we were. Everyone has learned a lot when it comes to Hearthstone, Callum.
Well, Zalay's finally getting his hand, apart from me, Zalay's getting his hand going finally here, gets into that Azure Drake. picks up a shade as well, but he had, yeah, so he has a second Azure Drake and a shade potentially to do what he wants to do next turn, and then has the Sophie's Choice of Druid decks, the turn seven,
yeah,
Ancient of Lore, Doctor Boom,
yeah. That tap into Thorasan is pretty good here for Hoi. It means that he more or less has his next turn locked up, so he just has to decide how he wants to address the board. And I think I'd probably like to see the Dart Bomb come down here to deal with this Drake. It's not like he has a minion to develop for tempo here that would incite just the double trade. I think the Azure Drake does demand to be respected. Well, it looks like he's just going to go ahead and corruption it here and just push phase, keep the Dart Bomb in his hand for potential damage.
Alright, we'll see that corruption being used. We'll see if Slay's able to make use of it. But he does have the swipe in hand, so he can swipe the first part of the Sludge Belcher.
Will
slightly punish the corruption.
Will still cause an additional spawn on the Imgang boss, though. Doesn't quite have the buff in damage to be able to deal that in one clean shot. So he would spawn an Imp and leave behind the 2-1 Imgang boss. So it's far from perfect, and I guess that was Hoi's consideration here when he chose to take the risk of leaving the Drake up.
Yeah, I'd say it's not too bad, but it might be a little bit... Oh yeah, he can do this the other way.
He can do it the other way, yeah, but
he's going to hero power.
He's going to hero power. Chooses to pass up the swipe. I guess he's, you know, there is usually implosion as a single copy in these decks, which can be backbreaking if it comes down after you've used your swipe, and also that Imgang boss will continue to spawn 1-1s. Yeah, even if you swipe it this turn, there's still going to be another 1-1 spawn from it, so... I guess he's just pulling things together. And now there is an Arcane Golem and an Abusive Sergeant getting discounted by that Emperor alongside just really nice value minions like Sylvanas and Boom. So,
yeah, it means you can play that combo on turn 8 if you pick up the Faceless and the Power Overwhelming. And that's a 20 damage combo, right?
7, right? Two mana Arcane Golem, 1 mana, 0 mana Abusive
Sorry,
Sergeant.
Sorry, Abusive, so it takes it up to 6. Then you add, no, yeah, so the Arcane Golem, I'm saying if you draw the Faceless and the
PO. Including the PO, right.
Yeah, if you draw the Faceless and the PO.
Sure. But yeah, I mean, he's lowered the Druid so much here that the Power Overwhelming is probably even surplus to requirements, which is why I wasn't considering it, so...
Sure, just the Faceless would be 12.
Yeah, if he picks up the Faceless next turn, he can just deal that 12 damage burst, so...
Yeah, if he picks up the Faceless this turn, or if Thorsen lives, he can also add the Dart Bomb. Maybe even the Hellfire if he wants.
Yeah, just go all the way in.
Yeah, if the Thorasin lives and he picks up Faceless, he can do... No, yeah, can't quite do Hellfire as well. And have to wait a turn for that.
Yeah.
But a lot of damage being built up in the hand here for Hoi.
And it's also, not only is it a great Emperor based on his hand and the amount of, you know, really, really promising cards that he's got discounted, it's also a great Emperor because it demands an answer from his Druid opponent on turn 7. It's something we've talked about a lot, you know, interrupting your opponent's turn 7, so that even if they do have the answer to get rid of your board, then you at least force them not to play a 7 drop. But Zalay is going to decide that dealing with that Emperor is way more trouble than it's worth, and he's just going to go ahead and jam the Dr. Boom here. And now how much damage does Hoi have? That's 7, 11, 13, 16. Can he get the Hellfire in there as well? Because if so, that's exactly 19. Yes, he can. This is
9, 11. Yep, there we go. So Hoi is going to take a win here. It's not going to be 3-0 sweep.
Yep. Hoi climbing his way back in, winning an unfavored matchup here with the control warlock, the Reno lock against the Druids. So this is the start of magical things. You do have to win some unfavored matchups along the way when you're this far behind. So now Hoi has his warlock to go into. What choices from Zalay here, Callum?
Warrior and warlock on the backswing.
Yeah, interesting.
So he's gonna have to win what we think is a mirror match. There's a good chance that it's a mirror match against the Reno lock, but we'll see. Well, Delete is going with the Warlock.
Okay.
So does that mean he's playing Zoo? We'll find out.
Yes, we will. I'm thinking, was Zalay one of the two people that was playing the Elise?
The Gormok.
The Elise Control Warrior thing. Was it Zalay?
Yeah, I think he was.
It was Zalay and Eloise, right?
Well, and Fire Up. I don't think we saw it from him.
Yeah.
I think we saw it from Zalay and Eloise.
All right, good to know. So he doesn't want to pick that matchup into the Control Warlock, it seems. So he's just going to go with the Warlock Mirror, and then he's going to have that Warrior as his final answer. So,
Yep, he is going to pick the Warlock, so we'll see in this mirror match, if it is a mirror match in the decks, or if it's just a class mirror match. It may well be Zoo from Zalea, say we didn't write down the archetypes yesterday in that long day. It was quite late in the day we saw Zalea's game as well.
Yep, CT players are just preparing themselves here. We're ready to go. Hopefully they get into it nice and soon. But it's going to be the Warlock mirror match. But like I said, Hoi has started the comeback here. He's won the unfavored matchup against the Druid. So this is the beginning of good things for him. But he needs this one deck to carry him. But the Arcane Golem variant of Reno Lock has been very popular in this format over the last 2 days. It's been the most popular form of the deck that we've seen. Even Life Coach's Strange Twist still has that Arcane Golem in there, even though it's a slightly unconventional build of it.
Yeah, absolutely. People are finding that they really favor the burst in the deck, just because it allows them to get that finish when they don't want to go so deep with the deck. Again, something like Druid, for example, where you can't really afford to go so late in the game that Reno is what wins you the game. You need to have some way of offensively finishing the game. Alright, these players just taking a second while they get into it. Here we go, we're getting into our fourth game of the series as Cezalee, 2-1 up here, both picking Warlock, and it is suspense. Okay, well, this doesn't necessarily tell us what deck it is from Zalae.
No, maybe I would lean towards Zoo in this case, but it still definitely could go either way, so we'll wait and see what the mulligan brings us.
Yeah, I mean, Bran in Zoo is pretty fun if you can dodge that Flame Imp. That's the only one you need to avoid.
Yeah, Hoi of the philosophy that you keep Reno Jackson. Many, many players are coming around to this. You know, especially when you're expecting aggressive decks, it seems like an obvious keep. But some players that I've spoken to have come around to it to say that you keep Reno in your hand in every matchup. This is the reason why you're playing this deck. You know, you're playing this inefficient build that has 30 individual cards. The reason you're doing that is Reno. So you want to draw that every game, therefore keep it in your opening hand. And it is the Zoo from Zalae.
Yeah, double peel, a little bit clunky, but does pick up a Voidwalker into a Peddler, so it's getting the curve.
Yeah, and as long as you have a Peddler, you're usually relatively happy as the Zoo player. Peddler is pretty much just an early game curve on its own. You can choose to play it as a 2-drop, you can choose to play it as a 3-drop alongside the 1-mana card that you pick up. And I imagine that flexibility here, due to the Creeper top deck, might just lead him to play the Creeper here, although playing the Peddler does let him immediately contest the Zombie Chow on board, so...
Yeah, I like the Peddler here because then you can play the 1-drop and the Creeper on turn 3. You can also just play the Peddler and the... Oh, there's a Zombie Chow of your own.
That is three pretty high-quality cards.
Yeah, I don't think you pick the PO because you're already staring at two.
Dude, triple PO is nuts. Like, it's the craziest thing. You just end game so quickly when you have triple PO in your hand. But yeah, it might be a little bit ambitious in this situation. You're still nice and early in the game, so maybe the Zombie Chow is the pick just to have that value stats. Yeah,
if this was a little bit later and Zalae had a few minions and there was the possibility of really hitting triple PO in the next couple of turns and like a turn 4 or 5, he needs to hurry up here though.
He does. Well, he does go for it. Wow, man after my heart. I am a big fan of the triple PO. But I would have liked the Zombie Chow there, I think. Like, if you said to a Zoo player, you know, would you put Zombie Chow in your deck if you could draw it before turn 2 every single game? I think, you know, roughly 99% of them would say, yeah, I'd have that card in my deck. Because the early game turns aren't about damage, they're about ball control. Zombie Chow is the best ball control one drop in the game. So being able to pick it up there where it's still early, that it won't offer a big heal to your opponent, seemed like a good choice there. But my initial reaction was power overwhelming. It's just, in terms of one mana cards, it's so far above the power curve of other one mana cards that you just feel like you have to take it every time.
The Knife Jugger is a nice pickup as well, particularly given you're looking at Creeper this turn.
Looks like he's looking at Knife Juggler this turn. Just gonna go ahead and jam that bad boy.
Alright, trades into the Chow as well to protect the Voidwalker.
Yeah, the problem is if that Chow ends up doing that one damage to the Voidwalker, you don't really have a... Mortal Coil looking for a Dark Bomb! Well!
Okay.
Boy.
Yeah, Hoi choosing not to coin the Mortal Coil last turn left that 1-1 alive. But double Haunted Creeper on the backswing from Zalae is definitely a good option. And actually, the the power overwhelmings with this haunted with these haunted creepers are quite good as well.
Yeah.
Because you can obviously trade up with the it's the same way as Abusive Sergeant, right? You can trade up with the creeper and then you maintain the board presence with the spectral spiders.
Yeah, and this is another reason why triple power overwhelming is just nuts. Like, you can afford to use one for ball control much more liberally, safe that you still have that 8 damage burst in your hand. You don't just have to get all three of them to go face. So, say for example, Coin Sludge Belcher comes out this turn. You have a really nice PO, and you still have all that backup damage in your hand from the other two POs. But he's going to need to keep drawing solid minions off the top. And it looks like Hoy is just going to disrespect the presence of these Haunted Creepers, thinks they're too inconsequential to bother with a Sludge Belcher here, and he's just going to go ahead and Dart Peddler. Picks up another Zombie Chow, which is a pretty nice inclusion.
Didn't want to go for the Undertaker.
Yeah, I wonder why, Callum. Turns down coining it out there. He did have a nice curve, could have coined out the Chow into the Belcher next turn into Emperor, but it looks like he's just going to go right ahead and coin out the Emperor next turn. Or maybe play the Sludge Belcher and coin out the Zombie Chow to hide it behind the Belcher. That's a consideration as well.
This is an awkward turn for Zalay. He can double trade and give up his Death Rattles, or he could use one of the Power Overwhelmings. But instead just goes face, disrespects the 2-2.
Yeah.
You would think keeping the coin here, he's looking at the coined Emperor.
It would seem that way, but this is what I mentioned on the previous turn. Zalay has to draw really well off the top of his deck for a few turns there, and he just whiffed twice with the Iron Beak Owl and the Lotheb. So, based on that turn, Hoy will have an excellent idea what the makeup of his opponent's hand is. There are two cards that have been there since the start that haven't been played, and one Peddler card that haven't been played. And his turn on 5 mana was Tap Pass. So, I think you can get a very solid read together that the contents of his hand is a ton of burst damage.
Yeah. There's not a lot going on in that hand of Hoy right now. But the triple PO, obviously that's 12 damage. We had it on the one attack, it's 13, so he's only looking for another 9 damage over the next few turns. And triple PO can end the game.
There is that Reno that can throw a spanner in the works, though, but if Hoy doesn't have a strong read on the fact that there is, you know, 3 burst damage cards, you might be thinking, you know, it's a Doomguard, a Power Overwhelming, and a Soulfire, maybe, something along those lines. He probably, you know, there's no way he's just thinking exactly triple PO, but he's thinking 3 burst damage cards, more than likely.
Yeah, so, he does need to have anticipated that, because that is the real problem here that he might have, is Zoo doesn't always have a huge amount of reach.
Yeah.
You know, he has something like a Doomguard, maybe Doomguard plus PO if you've got something else on the board. But if you just clear the board, you can often deal with that. But yeah, this amount of burst, the triple PO, and we see a Dark Iron Dwarf coming into hand, so now there's 14 burst from hand.
Yep.
So 14 plus the 3 is 17, only 5 shorts.
Looks like a good turn to use one of those POs for board control here, though. You can use the PO, fill your board with 1-1s, trade off one of them into the 2-1, and then just protect that with the Lotheb, because the 1-1s are so fragile, just so they get to do their thing again next turn. Seems like a pretty solid line here.
You always pick one of the ones you drew, right, rather than the Peddler one?
Yes, yeah, absolutely.
Because then he goes, oh great, one Power Overwhelming's down, I only have to worry about another one.
Yeah. So it looks like Lotheb is going to come down here. Is he going to add the Power Overwhelming to Proceedings here? He is. And,
it's the wrong one, isn't it? Yeah.
It is the wrong one.
It's the Peddler one.
So he's going to reveal what his Peddler card is and not what those two cards he's been holding on to are, which... maybe there's merit to this, because those cards that you've been holding on to, they could be Doomguards. They could be high mana cards that you haven't been able to play yet. Whereas a card that you've held on to for that long from a Dark Peddler... is pretty much only Power Overwhelming or Soulfire. So maybe Zalay is considering that there's less of a range of possibilities for that Peddler card to be, and that's actually less information to give away.
All right, well, we'll let him off then.
Yeah.
Give him that one. So, from Hoy's side, things here, a couple of nice zero mana cards as well now, the Zombie Chow and the Abusive. What does he have the opportunity to do with them? Can counter Lotheb if he wants.
He can, but I think, yeah, I mean, Lotheb, Sludge Belcher, those seem to be the primary two cards that he'd play here. Lotheb can test the board right now better than Sludge Belcher, but I think he knows that he's going to have to make a series of defensive plays here over the next couple of turns, because he's respecting that built-up level of burst that he probably has got the read on in Zalay's hand.
That would have been one off lethal if the Lothep hadn't come down there.
5, 6, 7, 8, 16, 18, 20. Yes, it would. So you can see just how explosive these powerful ones are. And there's a Doomguard. There is so much damage building up here that once the Belcher is dealt with, Hoi might be faced with the difficult decision of whether he has to reno from a pretty high health total here.
Doomguard's interesting here, though, right? Because you don't really want to play it because you're going to discard at best one of your other best cards.
No, there's no way you play Doomguard here. I think you're just Dark Iron Dwarfing, abusing one of the 1/1s into the 5/5, and then you decide whether to pick up the baddie trade with the Chow or not, or whether you want to be aggressive and push phase.
Which I feel like you do when you just get traded that burst into the Lothep.
Yeah, I think the 5 goes face for sure. And these 1/1s just get stuck in there as well. He can choose to trade like one in to play around Demon Wrath maybe, but seems a bit ambitious.
So Hoi could go look at the Siphon Soul instead and the Abusive Sergeant and trade away the two big minions. Would he be alive in that case? No, he would not.
No.
Very much not.
Because
there's 13 from hand, and there'd be 4 on board, so that would be 17. That would be exact lethal, right?
Yeah.
Because the Siphon Soul takes him up to 17, so he would just not be alive.
In terms of plays that keep him alive, he can Sludge Belcher Argus. Abusive Shadow Flame doesn't kill the 5/5 though. Right.
Yeah. So you can do this.
Oh, on the Belcher, right?
I was thinking on the Zombie Chow and play the Belcher. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Doing it on the Belcher is better, just to get the full clear. This definitely seems like the right line. Bran doesn't seem ideal here.
What are you doing, Bran?
Yeah.
I don't want you.
Okay, Egg is not bad here, because that's a minion that has high potential of sticking to the board. So, just going to play out the minions here, and then next turn he has the 9 mana he needs for double Power Overwhelming Owl and Doomguard. So, if he retains some sort of presence here, the Iron Beak Owl, though! The Iron Beak Owl is so huge! Iron Beak Owl, followed up by anything he likes here, really is going to clutch out the game. He can reno this turn. That will probably be the end of the game, but he might also choose to stretch out his reno value and just use a Defender of Argus this turn, or a Sylvanas.
I think your cat has some strong opinions about that.
Hey, what's up, Kupo? Hey, buddy.
All right, so yeah, it's very, very much pick your pleasure here from Hoi and how he wants to deal with this after picking up that Owl. And this is potentially a 5-game series. Is that our first 5-game series of the day?
I believe so, yeah. After nearly every series on the first day going to 5 games, I think this is the first one that we're going to see today.
He's left the target!
He's left the Power Overwhelming target on the board!
So, is that lethal?
It's one off. He has 13.
The cat's quite upset.
Yeah. The cat, it clearly is a Hoi fan. I don't know whether maybe he's sensing Pidgey around somewhere and this is a battle cry we're hearing coming out of it. But, he's got some strong words to say here.
Mortal Coil is decent.
Mortal Coil is not bad for sure.
Voidwalker is also decent as well, because you then end could play the double Voidwalker and those have got a good chance of staying around.
Oh my god.
Guards.
This is getting so awkward. This is why, this exact situation is why some players have started to make the switch to Leroy Jenkins in Zoo instead of Doomguard.
Yeah.
Because this right here, you just can't get that Doomguard to tie together with the Power Overwhelming. You're starting to get there as you build up more cards in your hand. You're giving yourself the possibility of it happening. But this situation where, you know, the Doomguards are just going to discard all your other burn. Leroy Jenkins allows you to just play from an empty board much more effectively with burst damage from hand, but he is going to go ahead and Owl here preemptively just to develop the board presence and just hope that this damage gets to push through, but I think...
Sun Fury and Argus now in hand.
I think that was his one turn window based on the slightly greedy play from Hoi by leaving the minion up, not taunting up, not playing Reno, etc., That was his one turn of freedom, and now the Reno Jackson is just going to lock out the game.
Yeah, Reno plus Sun Fury here is really just going to seal it. That Sun Fury top deck was actually pretty big.
Certainly is, yeah. Gonna go ahead and play it safe here, make the trades, but in this situation he can more or less do anything he likes. He's in such a comfortable position. Sun Fury comes down to just protect the Sylvanas. Not worried about taunting up here, he just wants to get the value out of that Sylvanas long term.
Well, what do we do here?
My attempt, I would attempt to make the play of Doomguard concede this turn. That would be my optimal line. Doesn't always work out because of the discard effect, but as long as I get that concede in at the end, I'm probably feeling pretty good.
Yeah. What a crazy end to this game here.
Yeah. So close, so many times from Zelay. We saw how bursty the triple power overwhelming allows you to be, and honestly, it probably comes down to that one turn where he drew Iron Beak Owl and then Lotheb off the life tap, so he had to pass an entire turn on turn 5. If he'd have picked up a little bit of extra pressure on that turn, he might have just been able to sneak through enough damage. But strong draw from Hoi, gets rewarded for keeping that Reno in hand, of course.
Show him the double PO. Show him the double PO. Because Hoi's got to be sitting thinking, what was he holding on to for so long?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure Hoi has a pretty good idea at this point. And I think that little look of recognition on Hoi's face there, his eyes just kind of widened a little bit as he saw the cards come out. So I think he had a pretty good idea of what he was up against. But this is going to be a fairly rapid spiral into defeat here from Zelay. And he's going to have to try and get the job done with his third deck, which we believe is that Elise Control Warrior.
Yeah, I think that's what we're going to see. And that, you know, isn't a matchup that he wanted into the Reno Warlock. Just goes to the Alexstrasza here.
Yeah, why not? Let's just get the game over and done with. Zelay, no way. With both Doomguards gone, a PO from Peddler gone, and a natural PO gone, there's no way that Hoi is scared of damage building up here, so he might as well just get the job over and done with. He has that Arcane Golem in hand to finish the job as well.
So many possibilities for Zelay, except none of them are good. Second PO trades up into the Alexstrasza, and he's going to Implosion the Sylvanas, rolls two, because of course he does. Yeah, that's gonna be the game.
Yeah, doesn't even give Hoi the satisfaction. Not dead on board, but he doesn't want to play this game anymore. He's gonna move on to an entirely different game of Hearthstone that isn't so filled with misery. And hope that what we believe, and hope that we haven't screwed up miserably, is his Control Warrior.
Yeah, and that's not a matchup he wanted to take into the Reno Lock.
No, it's not. He decided to. He had a better chance with the Zoo. It is one of those decks. It's not as effective as Druid, but it has the same philosophy against Reno as Druid does, which you can build a board that they can't deal with, and then Reno doesn't matter as much, as long as you have this consolidated board. It just so happens that the way his cards came out, he was kind of sat on this whole burst damage thing for the whole game. Like he was closer to playing like Face Hunter or Face Shaman than he was to Zoo, because he didn't really get the minions, he just got Owls and Power Overwhelmings, and so yeah, he wasn't able to build that board presence that would have been able to beat Reno, and just ended up just that fraction short for that one turn, the one damage off lethal situation. That was the only turn he had to the window, and then Reno came down and just crushed him out.
Yeah, he moved, he sort of faced himself towards being all in on burst with the triple PO choice, and the draws that came out, every draw that came out, pushed him more and more down being reliant on burst damage, and it just was never quite enough, but it was so close for Zelay.
It was. It's probably a little bit further away than it seems, because Hoi would have reacted. He probably calculated, for example, what double power overwhelming Doomguard did in that situation, saw that it was one off. Maybe if he saw that as an out from his opponent, he would have gone for a safer Reno. And hey, check it out, we were completely wrong. It's Patreon.
All right, fine.
Yep.
We did it, Twitch chat.
We did it. So I guess it was just Firebat and Eloise that was playing it on day one, maybe. Or are you convinced we didn't see Firebat's Warrior? We definitely saw the deck twice on day one, I'm confident.
Yeah, it must have been Firebat's then. Maybe that's a new Temple Storm pocket strat. Temple Storm Firebat confirmed?
Yeah, all right. Get those conspiracy theories out there, Callan.
He did play for Temple Storm in the Rebel tournament.
I loved Frodan's interview at the end as well, where he like asked he asked Reynad a bunch of pointed questions. Or how was it to work with Firebat? Is this something that you might want to do more in the future, etc. All these like leading questions, and then just didn't ask Firebat anything of the sort about the same thing.
Funny, because Frodan would definitely know if that was a thing.
Right. Yeah. Exactly.
There you go. So, Fiery War Axe to start with to deal with any early threats and some draw for Zalay. So, how does the Patron match up against Reno? We talked about the Control Warrior. Let's talk about the actual matchup.
Sure. So, there's a couple of ways that Patron can win this matchup. The first is the kind of hand that Zalay is looking at right now, which is early game threats and cycle. And you just get the early game tempo going, you curve out nicely into look. Like things like Lotheb and Dr. Boom, which again we see, and then you look to push through the last damage with Grom. And the alternate way is just to go all in on patrons as early as you possibly can, because they have one copy of Hellfire that deals with that early on. There's additional things that can get them out, weird combinations like Demon Wrath plus Dark Bomb sometimes gets the job done, but quite often you have 2-3-3 patrons on the board, so that isn't going to work. And so those are the two main lines you can go down. To try and get the job done as the patron player here. And Zalay here is beginning to cycle and has a nice amount of decent early minions in his hand, plus a battle rage to keep going. So it looks like he's going to be all in on the tempo strat in this game.
Yeah, coining out the whirlwind, a big tempo play, and as you say, all in on that tempo play, that whirlwind that could be very useful. And of course, the coin, very useful for getting those patrons early on.
Yep.
But valuing it on the acolyte here. And I mean, there is a Dark Bomb for Hoi, but with the Acolyte already down to 2 health, it's not a super valuable Dark Bomb play.
Yeah, so having already seen the Acolyte draw 1 card, is it worth using a high-value card like Dark Bomb when it interrupts my turn by so much? But it looks like Hoi believes it is. Probably is just going to go ahead and Dark Bomb down this Acolyte now to prevent the draw, and this is going to allow Frothing Berserker to come down on an uncontested board as a 3-4 here if he goes with this line.
Yeah, you gotta imagine he's using the Dark Bomb if he tapped here, but he's... Oh, okay, he's gonna use the Abusive instead.
Alright, interesting. I mean, it leaves a 2-1 on board instead of a 1-1, so I guess it does develop his board presence. Keep the Dark Bomb for later on for the patron turns as well, where it has more use than the Abusive, so... I guess that makes sense, but the same thing is gonna happen. That Dread Corsair is a really nice pickup to go with it.
Just fits the curve perfectly at this point.
Yeah.
So, Frothing Berserker can come down, as you say, as a 3-4, and then the Dread Corsair to protect it. Unanswered. So what would be Hoi's answer on turn 5? He does have a Sludge Belcher, could faceless the Frothing Berserker, but with the Dread Corsair on board, I think that's probably a bad idea.
Yeah, and the great part about this is that he has Lotheb to protect this board on the following turn. Oh, he's going to choose to keep the Axe as well. Wow, that's ambitious.
What is he anticipating with that?
I'm not sure, to be perfectly honest. I guess just the fact that he doesn't have a second weapon in hand. He doesn't want to expend his last weapon charge here on such a low-value minion. Next turn, you're expecting maybe a Belcher to come out from your opponent, which you know you can deal with the weapon and the Dread Corsair and keep the Frothing Berserker working pretty well. But you do also offer your opponent slightly more flexibility at being able to deal with the Frothing Berserker, which is such a high value threat in itself.
Yeah, so the Dark Bomb's going to clean that up. Now it's back to Zalay to rebuild his board. As you said, he did have the Lotheb to protect that in the following turn, but he can just Lotheb here for tempo, which is not really a better option.
No, it would have been significantly better if that Frothing Berserker was consolidated on the board, which is one of the reasons why I would have liked clearing the board, because the Lotheb follow-up was just so powerful if you were, you know, guaranteeing your chances of keeping those minions on board, and axing down the 2-1 definitely increases those odds in your favor. So I would have liked to see the swing come down there, but Zalay disagreed, chose to hold on to it, did get punished for it, but it was a very niche and unlikely punish combination of 2 cards, so... you can't really single him out too much for that play.
This is interesting from Hoi playing the Drake here, because the Drake does line up and to get killed by the Lotheb and the Axe Swing.
Mm. Also activates Battle Rage really nicely this turn if you'd like to. He can Battle Rage for 2 cards, clear the Drake, play a Shredder alongside it. Seems like a very solid turn.
Yeah, playing the Drake out where it just dies straight away. Okay, you disrupt your opponent's turn and they have to trade, but when you can see the damage representative on board. Zalae favoring the ghoul rather than the battle rage. So that suggests he's maybe going face? No, he's going to make the trade, okay.
Interesting that you'd voluntarily play a ghoul out there with the one health minion on board, but he has already seen the dark bomb used, which would be the primary method of dealing with this unstable ghoul. So I guess he just feels secure that 5-1 is going to be able to live for a turn here.
Yeah, some very interesting plays here lining up. And, you know, we talked about Hoy beforehand making plays that don't necessarily seem optimal, but do work out for him in the end. But this from Zalae, I am still a little bit confused, because even if, I guess, you know, you're as you say, the Dark Bomb is gone, so there's not that easy tool to deal with the 1-3, but if there is any way to deal with the 1-3, the 5-1 dies, the Shredder lives, so you get the same Battle Rage you would have done last turn.
Yeah, but I don't think the Battle Rage is being cast next turn because you have Dr. Boom in your hand. So
sure, that's... I'm trying to, because when I've talked to you about Patreon before, the consideration for Battle Rage is always how much value can I get from Battle Rage now, and how much is it going to be worth to me in the near future?
Right, and also how much does it cause me to slow down this turn as well?
Yeah, I just don't know that the. Oh, he does bait out the Arcane Golem, so that's not too bad.
Yeah, I guess it depends whether you consider that a win or not. You know, you lose a 5-1 and a 1-3 on the board, but now Zalae's back in this kind of decision where he has to evaluate whether he wants to Battle Rage or whether he just wants to develop the Dr. Boom here. If he develops Dr. Boom, it is potentially straight into a Twisting Nether turn from his opponent, but looks like he's going to go ahead and do it. Twisting Nether isn't that bad anyway. He'll push a bunch of damage to face with the Boom Bots, and then he'll have Piloted Shredder drop anyway, and then he just has Grom in a Rage in hand. So if Twisting Nether is cast, there's a very, very good chance that Zalae just has Lethal.
Yeah, this is what I was going to say. There's a really good chance of Lethal with Grommash in a Rage.
So I guess if that Battle Rage ends up not being cast this game and Zalae wins the game because of it, then you have to say his decision was correct. Because my worry was, if we don't cast the Battle Rage this turn, when do we cast it? But if the answer to that is you don't, we just win the game, then fine, your play was awesome.
All right, this is a potential game-losing play here from Hoy.
It's so unlikely that he's alive.
He's alive.
The combination of low-power minion from the Shredder and a low roll on the boombox is exactly what
he... Look at Zalae's face! Just, oh, no, but that... No.
Oh, wow.
Zalae's initial reaction was like, but no, that was supposed to be the winning play.
You just saw a closed capsule representation of the stages of grief right there. Like he saw the Twisting Nether came out, his face lit up, there was the smile, then there was the shock, and then that resignation of burying his face into his hands. Like, he cannot believe what's just happened here.
Oh my.
Wow. That outcome is everything, because it's the difference between death and Reno Jackson.
Like, right, so you had
to... That's about as big a swing as it gets in half.
So there had to be 6 damage represented. So you had a minimum of 2 damage from the Boombots, which would have meant you had to get a 4 power Shredder drop.
Yeah.
If the Boombots had done 2, you had the options of the 3s.
Yeah.
And then down to the 2s, if the Boombots had done... if the Boombots had done 8, you would have been on for Grom no matter what. So anything below 6 damage had to be at least 2. So insane.
But like, so an average Boombot roll of 5, which is weird, but like an average damage for a Boombot is 2.5, so you know, whatever. Average Boombot damage of 5 means that any Shredder drop with power would have won the game. So you are favoured in that situation for sure to have Lethal, so Zalae's shock is warranted. But yeah.
Well, how does Hoy come back here now? Because how much does he know that Grom is there?
Well, 9 mana unstable ghoul armor pass means there are situational cards in your opponent's hand. The problem when playing against Patron is that doesn't necessarily identify what those cards are. There are a ton of situational cards in the deck.
Yeah, it could be Patron, but no activators.
Yeah, it could be Whirlwinds, could be Inner Rages, could be Executes, you know, all these kinds of things. So. Oh, hey, it's a Patron.
There is a Patron. So what can we do this turn? We can... hit with the mist. don't think there's any way to clear this Belcher without using Grom, right?
No, you can do it. You just have to inner rage the unstable Gorm.
Oh, right, yeah, you have to use the inner rage.
That doesn't end up being the best play here anyway, because you want to get the battle rage value, more importantly. Your gambit to just push through with Gromash inner rage has failed at this point, so you need to refill your hand with more mid-rangey stuff so you can start to establish a board again if this patron goes down. Shredder's fine. Acolyte of Pain is not terrible either.
Double Death Spike straight off the top is a bit much.
But yeah, leaving that 3-3 up is going to punish him, because now the Shadow Flame is alive and well, as well as the Hellfire that would have been the out before if the board was clear.
Yeah, this I still can't get over that Twisting Nether turn, and the how unlikely that outcome was that Zalae didn't win.
Right. Like, it's not colossally favored. The numbers aren't huge in Zalae's favor, but he was definitely favored by a decent margin to win the game that turn.
Well, yeah, so the average Shredder drop is 2.
Yeah.
Which meant, and he was at 18.
Yeah.
So he had 14 damage with the average Shredder drop plus Grom inner rage. So he had to do 4 damage with Boombots.
Yeah, the average Boombot outcome is 5. The average Shredder power is between 2 and 3. So it's low 2s, so let's call it 2. So between those two averages, you have 7 damage, which would have been 11. So. But more importantly, Shadow Frame Reno this turn is the second time in quick succession that Reno has come down and crushed Zalae's hopes and dreams here, and he's going to have to find some way of building up a competitive board presence again this turn, but I just don't see it with this combination of cards. Pilot Shredder and Frothing Berserker are two of the better cards left in his deck that he could have right now, but with so many resources left in his opponent's hand, it just seems so unlikely.
How do you close this out from Holly here? You've got the 4-6 on board. Is there consideration at this point to
Alex your opponent's face? Yeah, I like it. You can Alex your opponent's face, and then...
You do have Dr. Boom as well, so...
You do have Dr. Boom, but you can Alex your opponent's face, and then if it sticks, which it quite often will because one execute is gone, you have, like, faceless your own Alex plus Argus the next turn. So yeah, it just seems like a huge amount of damage to push through, I think we can go.
Which comes under the heading of seems good.
Yeah, it does definitely come under that heading, especially with the Arcane Golem gone. That faceless doesn't really have any value. You might as well just use it to copy a huge minion. So I'm a big fan of the Alex and go face this turn.
Yeah, you're looking to use the faceless to develop board with the Arcane gone. It's looking at Zombie Chair, which doesn't necessarily mean no Alex.
It would be a bit weird to play a Zombie Chow on the same turn that you Alex your opponent's face, but I guess this is totally acceptable as well. This generates a huge board right now, as opposed to the two-turn Alex faceless thing, which generates a huge board 2 turns from now. It looks like he's just going to grind out this game, potentially a little bit more slowly, but he's still representing a ton of pressure here with this board.
It's a nice safe play.
Yep. Yep, definitely don't dispute that.
Look at Zalae's face. I think he's feeling pretty distraught right now. He's in the disbelief phase, I think, is what we'll call this one.
Yeah.
He's going to try and draw and get a huge Frothing Berserker, but the Berserker can be dealt with so easily. Let's see if he can get any good cards.
Just wait for all of these wonderful Hearthstone animations to happen. Slam isn't bad. He can now kill the Zombie Chow and that Reno if he wants to, but he might also feel like the Slam needs to cycle at some point this game.
He can use the Slam on the other Reno.
Yeah, he can use
still
it
get
to kill
trade.
The bigger Reno. So his options were kill the bigger Reno or kill the smaller Reno and the Chow. Well, that's an explosive sheet.
Shredder drops have not gone in Zalae's, but look at that. Zalae's just like, what is going on? What is happening? Shredders, why have you forsaken me? That sad face.
Yeah. So I think we end up seeing a board clear perhaps this turn. If the Zombie Child dies, he can then immediately bypass that healing by playing the Alex straight afterwards, but there's a lot of ways to go about this. He can choose to trade into the Armorsmith first before hitting the sheep to reduce the outcome. He has to send something into the Frothing Berserker, which is probably the 2-2 that's going to die anyway. So he has a lot of ways to consider here, whether he wants to reduce the armor, whether he wants to, which minion he wants to lose, and to trade into the 14-3, and then what cards he's playing from hand here. So He is going to go ahead and reduce the armor first by killing the armorsmith. No reason not to. Imagine the 2-2 goes into the 14-3. And, yep. And then the sheep gets traded out, and he's going to go with Peddler into Boom here, it looks, instead of the Alexstrasza. But would have been vaguely amusing, right? To heal your opponent with Chow and then just immediately Alex it off again.
Yeah. No, it would have been a pretty good response to it as well.
Yeah.
And yeah, he did manage to queue all that up.
Whoops.
Yeah, didn't clear. Yeah, that didn't work. I thought he managed to queue the Boom up there, but I think he left the Discover a little bit too late there. And you can see from Hoy's face.
Wow.
That's not gone well.
Wow. From Hoy's perspective, I really hope that that doesn't come back to bite him. Like I said, there was a lot of things to consider that turn in terms of how you were attacking down the board, whether the sheep was, you know, how to make the sheep work in your favor, what you were going to refill with afterwards, whether you wanted to use the Alexstrasza offensively or just go with the Dr. Boom play. And he just waited that fraction of a second too long. Probably just didn't factor the Discover timing into his turn. Probably would have been better off after he started roping to just skip the Discover altogether and just slam Boom just for safety. But yeah, ends up roping, and that's actually just created a little bit of breathing room here for Zalay, but he's not able to take advantage of it too heavily.
Yeah, he does have Patron in hand, so he can generate some patrons next turn, but you'd think either the Boom or the Alex is going to come down now.
Yeah.
And the... Well, the Dr. Boom into the Death Spite is interesting because it can either help or hinder Zalay's Grim patrons. I feel like it would probably just snipe his patrons completely after how this game has gone for him. So yeah, the Boom does come out this turn.
Okay. I mean, this could be everything right here. Slam on the Boom, patron in a rage, good Boom bots with no Hellfire in his opponent's hand could actually see him come back in this game here. It's kind of crazy. Picks up the Armorsmith, which is a great draw just to put an additional Boom bot target on the board, because from his perspective, if those Boom bots miss the patrons entirely, he's happy with the outcome of this turn.
Yeah, all right, let's see. Boom is gonna hit. Of course, armor gonna be built up, which is nice.
This is a huge moment for Zalay. Someone who hasn't had a lot of boom so far. The boom box. One goes face. Second one kills the 5-1. That is fine. Zalay will take that for sure. There's the health!
Oh
my god.
After a near perfect Boombot RNG there to make up for the imperfect Boombot RNG the previous time from his own side. There's the Hellfire, and I feel like that's the end of the game. There's so little that Zalay can do now.
That is just completely backbreaking. Zalay's deck is out of resources now, pretty much. We've seen both Frothings, both Patrons, Lotheb, Dr. Boom. Pretty much all he has left now is this Grommash Hellscream and a Dream. And the Siphon Soul is here to quickly take care of that. This is going to be the series going to Hoy here.
That was insane. I mean, I feel like hitting the 5-1, and I mean, hitting face, whatever, but kill it. The only minion died was the 5-1.
Yeah.
Leaving the Armorsmith alive was pretty much perfect, right?
Pretty much. I don't know what's going on with Zalay right now. I think he might have actually completely had a mental break due to this series.
I wouldn't blame him, to be honest. That was crazy.
I've had mental breakdowns over Hearthstone about less than that, so I definitely wouldn't blame him.
Oh my god, that last game. Well, where do we start, Sol? The twisting the other turn, of course, we've talked about in detail. The Boom bots letting him down, the Shredder letting him down.
Yeah.
The explosive sheep from the Shredder as well.
Yeah.
Was pretty suboptimal.
Like, it was annoying. That wasn't a huge deal as the other factors we saw in that game, because the board was fragile anyway. It's not like that Frothing was gonna stick around if the sheep didn't come out, for example. So the cleanup would have been there from Hoy, and if anything, the sheep ended up working in his favor, because Hoy just kind of got a little bit mind screwed and wasn't able to work out what to do in time. Gave that kind of one turn reprieve back over to Zalay. But the Hellfire top deck and the Boombot Shredder outcome on that turn with potential lethal, both of those were just huge breaks for Hoy and really, really tilting for Zalay. So that was one game that definitely could have had a variety of different outcomes just based on the variance of some of the cards.
Was he completely out of that game if Hoy played the Boom when he meant to?
No. He would have taken... It would have been the same... Well, actually, no. Yeah, it would have been pretty crucial because the Alexstrasza could have been developed the turn afterwards just to put on a ton of pressure. He wouldn't have had time to go for the big patron play that he got two turns later. So, yeah, not playing the boom actually cost him that one turn that could have been crucial if not for the Hellfire top deck.
Yeah, that was a pretty big mistake for Holly to make, and he's going to... It's kind of awkward because he's won the match, but I feel like that mistake is going to be what he takes away from this series going into the semifinals and thinking, right. You know, he needs to avoid that. It's going to be an all-European semi-final between Hoy and Life Coach, mm-hmm. Which guarantees European representation in our final, which means that your boy Ryzen, the last hope for North America in our tournament, he's going to go up against 6-0 in our first semi-final. That's what we're going to go to next after going to a short break, but then Hoy versus Life Coach. The all-German final, which is what some people have predicted, 6-0 versus Life Coach in our final. Sato, what do you make of our semi-final lineup and any thoughts on that series we just saw?
I mean, I've given a lot of thoughts on that series. We could talk for days. That was a crazy series, back and forth, all sorts of things. Yeah, great high-level play, and then the little Hearthstone twist at the end where the outcomes of cards kind of decided a little bit.
Esports.
At the end. Yeah, but looking at the semi-final lineup, there's a bunch of great stories in here. 6-0, again, the dominance of 6-0 in this kind of 16-man format is just so huge. Him, again, is making a great run here. Ryzen, kind of the unappreciated player in the bracket, making a great run. My Complexity teammate, proving his worth, making sure he's here to hang with the big boys. And then Life Coach and Hoy on the other side of the bracket, two of Europe's very best fighting for a spot in the final. So hugely excited to see what goes down in these last three games or so. And I believe we are ready to go to a very quick break, and we'll be back with our first semi-final. Don't go anywhere, guys.